Hey, we're live. Hello, everyone. Well, thanks, LD Mobile. This is NBL Overtime. I'll tell you what, we had Homicide telling a story. The TV up here apparently doesn't work anymore.
Oh, my God.
And I had no idea. But, hey.
Okay, we're live.
Welcome. Hashtag see incredible. What a huge weekend in the NBL. Corey was telling one of the most riveting stories I've ever heard. Like, literally. It went for, like, 24 minutes, and I don't really know what the hell happened at the end. Either way. Hello to everybody. How you doing? How you doing, man? Apparently we're wrong. What up?
I'm good. What's going on, man?
I don't know what's going on. It was a huge weekend in the NBL. It's all kind of just blended into one. And we sit here today for a false start of 15 seconds. Got Guy yelling in my ear and telling us we're on. Liam Santa Maria, Studs and Duds is live, nbl.com.au. Hello, buddy.
Hello, mate. The that unpredictable start, it's a perfect microcosm of the NBL and the round we just saw because... You never know how it's going to go. Upsets left, right and centre, and this thing's just tight as you can get.
Hashtag see incredible's never been more apt, and the fact is that probably the only consistent and predictable thing in the NBL in 2019-20 is the unpredictability. And we talk about the closest of the competition, and the very fact is that while Sydney and Perth have been by themselves a little bit at different points at the top of the table, from three all the way down to eighth, and even ninth with the way the Illawarra hanging around and winning some games, and are going to play a bit of a spoiler in the second half of the year, it is so fun to watch. And we're going to get to who is probably the team you're least likely to want to face as the time goes on. But essentially, as it seems right now, no one's got any idea when we get to the arena to watch a game.
I think that's the beauty of the NBL. As you can see, anybody can beat anybody. You know, literally, that's why, first of all, I love working for this league and I love pushing the league the way we push the league, because it's literally, you don't know who's going to win. There's so many leagues in the world where, okay, in Europe, with all due respect, they have 15 teams in a league, 10, 12, 14, 16 teams in a league. Top six teams are the best teams. The rest of the league, it's a night off. Imports could take nights off, and the top team will still win. You cannot do that in this league. That's why I rate this league as one of the best in the world, period.
This Sydney team, that was a nice dunk. And if anyone's seen the photos too that are getting around the Josh Ontain, who is, again, really, really good. And, of course, this game and Finn Delaney, who's been really good. Part of that winning streak in New Zealand, five-game winning streak, involves Finn Delaney getting back on the court and playing his best, probably his best month of basketball consistently in the NBL. And then, of course, this one was Ripper and Lamar Patterson. We'll get to him later when it comes to MVP discussions. But a weekend that continually boggles the mind.
And every a lot of these games feel a bit like finals, right? Like Brisbane, they lost to Cairns, and then they have Perth at home. And what were they at the time? I think maybe 8 and 11. And you look at that Perth game and you think, oh, geez, if they lose this, I mean, it could be Red Rover for the Bullets pretty much. And they pull it out. Adelaide taking care of business against Illawarra. Melbourne doing the same. Teams, when, and you spoke about it on your socials during the week, when their backs are against the wall, they are responding. And of course, the New Zealand Breakers are the biggest example of that.
And it leads us to the question, who do we have making the playoffs? It's been a conversation that we've had since the start. Perth Wildcats and the Sydney Kings have touched on, of probably in the eyes of many, fairly safe. But that Melbourne all the way to Southeast Melbourne Phoenix is such tightly contested. We'll get into what happened over the course of this weekend coming, but a lot of these teams play each other, and it's headlined by Cairns and New Zealand to kickstart Thursday night. I'm going to go to you, third and fourth Homicide, right now. Who have you got finishing there?
Exactly how the board is right now.
Yep.
I actually have Cairns finishing third. This is a big weekend for the Taipans. I believe in the Taipans. The MVP of the league is their point guard. And they are going to get third place. They're going to have a huge weekend this weekend. They're going to ball out. They're going to get W's, and that's going to solidify their position.
New Zealand first, and then they travel to Sydney to Kudos Bank Arena to take on the Kings. So if they go 2-0 this weekend, it's going to go a long way to solidifying their position that I think everyone believes right now is theirs to lose.
But if New Zealand go 2-0 this weekend, if New Zealand beat Cairns and they go home and they beat Brisbane, and that streak goes from 5-7...
That's incredible in itself.
Right. I mean, they've been sensational. Honestly, who knows?
That's true.
You have to go with Melbourne and Cairns right now because they've got a head start. And because we've seen that we love, you know, the talent that they have on board, they've shown the ability to get wins when they need them. But would it completely shock you to see one of those teams miss in New Zealand or Adelaide to get in, for Brisbane to, you know, Lamar Patterson to put them on his shoulders and get them all the way in? No. So to sit here and suggest we know how it's going to play out is crazy.
I was thinking about this today. Like, the fact is that, like, and you just mentioned it, Machado, MVP of the league. If New Zealand make it, it'll probably be Scottie Hobson. It's such a different narrative to what's happened in the past, because we are almost, and I think probably understandably, ignoring the most valuable player candidates. So have the Sydney Kings, the Perth Wildcats, Cotton, of course, great. We know how good most of those Kings players have been. But whoever finishes fourth, and you've pushed this from the start, or even third, if it's Cairns around those other three teams, say Melbourne do make it, it will be Machado, I think. If it's New Zealand, it'll be Hobson. If it's Southeast Melbourne, Phoenix, I think it'll be Mitch Creek. You obviously disagree.
No, I do disagree.
Okay.
Because, I mean, I get what Corey's saying with that, and certainly Machado and Hobson are and Patterson, those three, Mitch Creek with Southeast Melbourne, are carrying a big load for those teams. And if any one of those teams make the playoffs, that player will have done a terrific job. But heck, if the Wildcats finish this season strongly and they finish top or right there, then Bryce Cotton is most likely going to have had a big, big say in that.
Right.
And he's the MVP for me.
The thing that I will say about that, though, and this is sometimes what we do in sport, we look and an expectation is set. So for the Perth Wildcats, we all assume we're going to have a pretty good year because we're used to it for the last 4,000.
Yeah.
So I think it sometimes hurts the most valuable player credentials of a player within that team. I'm not suggesting that Bryce Cotton shouldn't or wouldn't be the MVP, but I also think that we are bolstering the idea of a team who finishes really well and makes the playoffs that somewhat surprised us.
Yo, you're absolutely right, Liam, with Bryce Cotton. Bryce Cotton, the best player in the league. I agree with you with that. But like you just said, just like in the NBA, when you're talking about LeBron James, if that was the case, he'd be MVP of the league every year with the stuff that he does. But when you are a great player, it becomes normal. We take advantage of, we don't actually respect it like we should because it's normal. It's the norm with what Bryce Cotton does. But what we're seeing from a team that had 5 wins last year or 6 wins last year and to where they're at right now, that jumps off my paper more than anything else. So I agree with what you're saying, but, you know.
The thing is, though, it's not like he doesn't have any help. I mean, Cam Oliver is arguably All-NBL first team. DJ Newble has something to say about that. He's their team-leading scorer.
Defensive player of the year. That's why he and Scotty Hobson, that's the matchup right there. We'll get into that later.
And I know we're going to talk about MVP a little bit more in double overtime, but I want to say this. I would like to see some clubs and some fan bases out there doing some champagne and campaigning.
I agree.
I want to see some MVP chants when guys are at the free throw line.
That is something that we've never seen in the NBL, at least for a long period of time. We see it in the NBA all the time. They're continually pushing their player for a certain award, be it the most valuable player or most improved or all-star, whatever it might be.
Yes.
I want to see, it's just to you, the social media managers at the clubs who do a wonderful job, I want to see them start to push and sell the narrative individually. It's not an individual sport, I understand. But the fact is, this is what will get the NBL to a whole new level when we learn more and more about these superstar players, of which these are some of them, on a day-to-day or game-to-game
basis. I'd like to open the front door of my house to a delivery man with a Scotty Hobson for MVP little package.
Right.
You know?
Well, you know what?
Brand,
you know what
I'm saying? Brand you like?
I just want to get...
Well, see it if you, you know, hey, any kind of brand.
You know what I mean?
Hey, funny that, because you might be getting a package from the New Zealand break. Well, if this team continues to play well and make the four, you're going to be in a T-shirt.
Okay, so what about this?
Hit me.
What if, for some wild reason, United don't make it, Cairns and New Zealand both make it?
Well, you answer.
Who's the MVP of the league?
You tell us, because you.
I don't know at that point.
It's probably Bryce Cotton.
Why? Because that's the easier pick to make.
No, because that is, for me, that's the crazy MVP.
Well, all right.
I would know for. I wouldn't have it.
We'll
I
have
don't
to
know.
See how.
I'll ask you this. New Zealand and Cairns play this weekend, as we've touched on, and they're two teams that are probably the two hottest teams in the league. If you're a Perth or you're a Sydney or you're really anyone, who are you least likely wanting to face, New Zealand or Cairns?
I wouldn't want to face Cairns, because Cairns have beaten those teams that are contenders for the championship. Mm-hmm. So that's the last team you want to face. You'd rather face New Zealand before Cairns.
I agree. They've been the giant killers, right? And we've seen their ability to come up big in those big games. They've won in Perth, in Sydney, and in Melbourne. New Zealand are, my calculations, I think they're 0-6. Against those three. Now, some of those have been without Scotty Hobson. We know they're 1-6 without Hobson on the year, 8-4 with him. So they're a completely different team now than what they were at the start of the year. But we need to see them beat some of those big dogs before we say that they are the scariest proposition in the playoffs.
You know what would scare teams? Because if New Zealand get on this run, and they've got record-breaking crowds, huge crowds all year, they get on this run, Cairns are similar, of course, because that gym's starting to rock anyway. You have to get on a plane and go to New Zealand on the back of a really big second half of the year, momentum building led by Scotty Hobson. This is interesting. I'm not traditionally a huge believer in home court advantage or home pitch or home field advantage in sport, because I think when you're the creme la creme, you handle a lot better. I think the better team win. But if you have to go to New Zealand and you take on a team that's second half of the year, if they make the playoffs, there will almost be an argument they're the best team in the NBL in the second half of the year, considering where they were at the halfway point. It's going to be scary to have to go and close a series out in front of those New Zealand fans who are losing their mind.
We talk about it all the time. There is no game in this league that you can pencil in. Now, Illawarra are almost at that point. You assume you're going to win. Now, we've seen them beat Sydney and we've seen them beat Adelaide recently and so on and so forth. Teams, Melbourne and Adelaide, both took care of business. That was the result we expected, and more than not, we're seeing it. But with everyone else, who knows? That applies to a single game, applies to a series as well.
Perth Wildcats have lost three of their last four. They obviously beat Sydney a couple of weeks ago, and we're starting to really jump on that bandwagon, and it's one that we very rarely get off because the Red Army and the Wildcats are so great. Are you at all concerned?
I'm not concerned. You got to still remember their main guy, Damian Martin, is out right now. You know, he does so much for them defensively. The pressure he applies up the court, that really hurts the opponent's point guards. And everything he does is just invaluable. And is when he's not on the court, it hurts. So they're not going to win every game. You're not just waltzing through this league like you used to. But you know how Bryce Cotton does. I've learned. Down the stretch, they will be fine.
You motivated him last year, man.
I did.
Mm-hmm.
I did.
That's the springs.
Whew. You saw the bounce? Like, come
on.
His
bounce is so cool.
Yeah.
I'm concerned. I'm concerned about their defense. I've been harping on about it, and I sometimes I find myself a little boring how much I talk about defense. But I've been talking about their inconsistency at the defensive end all year. Some weeks we see it, this week, and the last game before this against Adelaide, we didn't. And yeah, they didn't have Damian Martin in those games, but last year, late in the season when he was out, they went 6-0 without him because they had their ish together at the defensive end. And my understanding is that front office, that coaching staff, they feel the same way. They're concerned. And they've got seven games left. You know how many games you got to play as a new player to qualify for the finals?
Seven.
This is the week. They're going to make a change at the middle with Dario Hunt, bring in someone new.
Did you say if they're going to make a change?
If they're going to make a change,
got to be this week.
This is the week. And my understanding is that there's movement at that station. Now, will Dario Hunt definitely be not be in uniform this weekend? No, because the clock's ticking on getting the paperwork done and all kinds of things like that. But my understanding is there's movement at that stage.
Is it your belief that they have spoken to a player?
Yes.
And they are very close to getting a signature on paper?
Yes.
Hashtag see incredible.
Which I want to say is this situation that's playing out with the Wildcats, much unlike what we thought happened, my understanding is, what I'm told, this is what happened last year when this team got its ish together midway through the season. They were, remember that loss to Cairns?
Yep, in RAC Arena.
In RAC Arena. And the talk had been the third import.
Right.
And Trevor Gleeson and they'd also,
I believe in his team, blah, blah, blah. And then, whew.
That was the week to get it done. They had eight games left, but it was a doubleheader coming up. My understanding is the real story about that Perth Championship last year, they had a guy agreed and ready to come. A wing, not a five, like maybe we thought at the time. We thought also maybe a wing. A wing, and he was ready to come. Tom Jervis was being moved out of the roster. This guy was coming in. The next day he pulled out. It was too late to get to make the change and go with someone else.
They ran with what they had.
They ran with what they had, and Tom Jervis was all world in the finals.
Shout out to Tom Jervis.
Quick yes or no. Is the player Keith Benson?
No.
This guy, man.
No.
Well, speaking of Keith Benson, he's no longer at the South East Melbourne Phoenix, of course, parting ways mutually in the last seven or so days. He wasn't, of course, in uniform when they lost to New Zealand over the course of the weekend. And it continually starts a conversation about what they're going to do and replace. Before we get some names from Liam Santa Maria, what type of player do they need, Homicide?
Well, I would say a center, but why would they bring in a center when they have the most improved player in the NBL? Mm-hmm. 17 and 19 rebounds.
Nope.
Something like that.
17 and 20.
20. I'm sorry, 20 rebounds.
They bumped it up.
Unbelievable performance by Dane Pinot, first of all. Love your work, and I appreciate what's going on, but I believe, you know, like we discussed a little bit off camera, I think they need a wing player. Mm. Because down the stretch of this game, mm-hmm. no one was able to create off the dribble and get a bucket. And the offense dried up because of that. They're overplaying him, Roberson. So it's hard for it to just be solely him having to create. Outside of that, who else can really create and go on and get you a bucket off the dribble?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. I think there's also something, I mean, this is a team that's building, right? They're building from the ground up. Mm. This is year one. Let's not forget that. We're talking about them competing for a playoff spot, but keep in mind this is year one. So you got to lay some foundations and you got to make some statements about who you are and what you want to be about. And Dane Pinot is giving you absolutely everything. And it's not like he's just the little engine that was trying to push up. 17 and 20.
That is incredible.
And apart
from most rebounds this year.
Most rebounds since 2009.
Hey, and first ever father-son to snaffle 20 because of his, course, his Brad, his dad in the early 80s did it on a number of occasions, actually.
And, awesome. And when you go through their games, apart from Sean Long, they're not getting monstered by centers.
Right.
They're having trouble staying in front of anyone. Their defense has a lot of cracks in it. And then in crunch time, as you said, of that crucial game against New Zealand, they just couldn't get a bucket. And they've got Adam Gibson banged up. They've got Kendall Stevens carrying a bit of an ankle injury. And he hasn't been getting on the floor at all. And the other thing is, we talk about Mitch Creek. Simon Mitchell mentioned about how he hasn't trained for a long, long time. He's pretty banged up as well. The other thing is, I think we've seen over the course of this season and previously, Mitch Creek is way more effective at the four. Mm-hmm. So you want to play some minutes with Pinot, Wesley and Creek and use him at the three? Sure. But also, let's see some minutes where either Wesley's out and Creek's at the four, or Wesley's at the five and Creek's at the four. So that's, and my understanding is that this is what they've been throwing around.
Give me some names.
Trying to decide.
Yeah. Give me some names.
Well, they were looking at some centers.
Yeah.
So there were some names there. A guy named Angel Delgado.
I know Angel Delgado, Puerto Rican, used to play with the national team.
Looking at him, all G League first team last year. Eric Micah was on an Exhibit 10 deal with Sacramento at the start of this season. Even Zebo's name.
Hey. They should get him cheap. He knows the owner.
He's one of the owners.
He is one of the owners.
I tell you what, hashtag C incredible. Because
that would
someone,
be crazy
if someone took a punt that an owner would play some minutes this year. Hey, just recently retired.
That's right.
That would be crazy. That would be sick if Zebo came out here.
My understanding, though, is that they agree with what we're saying here at the desk, that they feel like they need a wing to try and make this playoff push, right? So here are some of the guys that have been on their list.
Hit me.
Let me hear it.
Jonathan Simmons. Ooh. You might remember him from the Spurs.
Had 34 on opening night against Golden State Warriors a few years back.
But I think he's about to get an NBA gig, so he might be now off there. They have thought about and made some contact with Devondrick Walker, who was set to play with the Wildcats a couple of seasons ago and broke his foot. They like his three-point shooting. KJ McDaniels is a guy that they've been having a pretty close look at. Super athlete. You remember him from the 76ers. Wayne Selden.
I know.
New Orleans, Memphis, Chicago.
Yes,
he's a baller.
Yes, he is.
He's a real baller.
Yes, he is.
And a couple of other guys who I won't mention their names because they're you know, there's one of those situations, a bit like what Keith Benson's was, where he was still under contract, but his agent was wheeling and dealing. Do you know what I mean?
Right.
So I won't mention those names. But, and I'll tell you what, I've been in the presence of Tommy Greer and Simon Mitchell. Those guys, I mean, they don't look like they're getting any sleep right now as they work the phones and try to find the right guy. They have a week up their sleeve.
Have they loosened the purse strings?
No. Okay. Why do you say that?
I just you mentioned four players there who aren't going to be cheap. And they're all ballers, and I understand it's a shorter, you know, it might only be seven or eight games left, however many exactly they've got left. But they're high-profile NBA guys who aren't going to be cheap, and that's the question.
Didn't have to pay out Keith Benson.
Didn't have to?
Didn't have to in the end because he got a job elsewhere in Dubai or somewhere like that. So that's a big factor, and that allows them to now have a look at one of these guys. And I'm going to try and make a playoff push.
Well, nbl.com.au to keep it locked on there as well. And that's also, well, that's not the best place to get involved in Santa's watching, because you can hit him up at Liam_Santa, because you guys and girls at the NBL arenas right across the country do all the hard work, and then Liam Santa Maria takes all the credit, mate. So what do you got for us?
Let's roll the vision and so I can remember where we're starting. Oh, yeah, EJ Singler taking a little tumble and Mike Kelly helping him out. Tickets, things. Look, there he goes. This is just people helping people. Look at Mirko Jerick right here on your right. Oh, it's a little squirt.
They're loving life.
The physio's kind of like, yeah, are you for real? Watch the guy over Matt Russell's, his right shoulder on our left. Check him out up the back there. Whoop.
And he's off. I've got that shirt.
Mate, lots of great crowd shots. Josh Byrne's very popular in the gong, just quietly. Very popular. And I enjoyed this in Adelaide. What, as the camera pans up, we eventually catch the star of the show. There he is in the Cam Luke sort of get up with the open shirt, the blue with the white. He's up. He notices he's the... And now he's like, it's my moment. He's doing
everything.
Every single move that he's got. And the crowd absolutely loved it. And Corey was talking, but his mic wasn't near his mouth. He's like, oh, hold on.
You guys can't hear me?
There you go.
Beautifully done. To everyone else around the country who continue to send stuff to Liam Santamaria. All right, from that to this, top 10 plays of the week, all thanks to LD Mobile.
We're up to round 14, so let's do this thing. It's your LD Mobile MBL top 10 at number 10. Southeast Melbourne opts not to guard Scotty Hobson as he cuts back door, allowing him to get off the floor for the score. Scotty Hobson to the rim to throw that one in at number 10. On to number 9, and the International Commission on Highlights has decreed that your top 10 is a sham unless you have a Space Cam slam for the Cans Tie Pans. But this plays a duet, so who can do it like Cam? Where's my DJ to complete the number 9 play? It's Newbill completing the thrill for the Cans fans with a second slam at number 9.
DJ Newbill with a steal. Goes up and finishes, gives the crowd some energy.
On to number 8, and it's Bryce Cotton running free at the Armory. Just sit back and watch the 6-footer lay this one in. No! That's a two-handed hammer throw. Cotton rocking the rim in Brisbane at number 8. At number 7, Adelaide's Eric Griffin gets the steal, and on his way to the hoop, he throws in a Karl Malone tribute. Apparently, the 36ers have a mailman of their own who's paying homage at the throne. Eric Griffin gets in at number 7. On to number 6, where Nathan Sobiwan Kenobi is playing defense in the post. And even with the force, that little man there is toast. Space Cam's not afraid of your Star Wars the way he gets up off the hardwood for his scores. Cam Oliver in at number 6. At 5, even at the end of the game, Melbourne United are still bringing the pain. Chris Golding tosses it up, and Sean Long delivers the punctuation and the detonation. Mr. Double-Double hammering the rock against the Hawks at number 5. To Sydney for number 4, where the Kings are on the break as Casper Ware finds the trailer and rising in the air. It's Jay Sean the Impaler. I fear for your fate if you go up against Tate, because he's rising in the skies and you best not be late. Jay Sean is on the countdown at number 4. At number 3, we check in with Nick Kay to watch him slay Will Magnay. St. Nick's too quick and Will gets played on this airborne trick as Nick Kay gets in at number 3. On to number 2, and the Batman and Robin of the top 10 are back again as Chris Golding sets up Sean Long for the stuff at the rim. CG43's dime sends Mr. Double-Double flying for United at number 2. But at number one, I'm totally flabbergasted because Space Cam goes up for the dunk, but his shot gets blasted. That's nothing but pumpkin as Will Magnay saves the day, soaring in for the block and the number one play on the NBL. Cut it!
Week 14, top 10, all thanks to LD Mobile.
Thoughts on the top 10?
Hit me.
Shout out to the ref. I don't know who it was, but play number five when Cam Oliver backed down Nathan Sobey. That's how you get rid of flopping.
We had this conversation.
Not saying he flopped.
No, but I agree.
But let him sit. Mm-hmm. Let him get dunked on. Let Cam Oliver just look down at him for a moment. That's how you do it. And also, shout out Will Magnay. Play number three was...
Whoa, hold on. Two-way Magnay. He's got to use his real name, doesn't he?
Shout out Will Magnay. Gets the number one play for blocking Cam Oliver. You know why he gets that play? Because of what things like the number three play, where Nick Kay throws it down on him.
Yeah.
He is not scared at all. And that's why he has those moments.
Hashtag see incredible. All right, around the nation right now, we understand there are a lot of people who are doing it really tough. And when a nation hurts, a nation unites. And so many people, both in the sporting world and outside of it, have done a wonderful job to help many people who are going through a really rough time and continually to do so as the bushfires ravage this beautiful country. And the NBL has not been unique in their way of being able to raise money. We've seen over the course of the weekend players in their own way in clubs put their hand up and find different and creative ways to be able to donate to people who are doing it tough. And today, the NBL, the clubs and the Players Association pledged $100 each over the course of week 15, $300 for every three-pointer made as we head to the first week, this weekend coming. It's an outstanding initiative to help people who are struggling. Boys, and I know that Hungry Jack's and Chemist Warehouse, keep your eyes peeled as well, because I'm pretty sure they're in discussions to be involved as well and continue to donate to many people in need. And while we all send our thoughts and our prayers to so many people right now who are doing it tough, everyone in the NBL community deserve to be congratulated, like many do in the country, who are going through and trying to put their hand up and help in any small way possible.
I think it's an incredible initiative that what the NBL is doing, what the players are doing, the Players Association, everybody, you know, whatever you can give, you give. It's really sad what's happening. You know, I consider Australia my second home. So trust me, I'm feeling it just as much as everybody else. So whatever you can do, whether it's a post, donation, giving clothes, whatever you can do is very important to give.
Yeah, proud of the basketball community under these circumstances. Proud of the whole nation, right? And the way everybody's responding and rallying around the relief and recovery effort. And shout out to those people that are on the front lines fighting those fires. And I tell you what, and the people trying to protect their homes and their loved ones. But yes, within our own little basketball community, it's been a fantastic response from the teams and the owners and the players and the supporters. And we just need to keep it going though, because it's easy, right? Not easy, but sometimes this happens right in the heat of the moment, but this is going to be an ongoing effort. And, we've made a good start.
And you, the fans at home, can donate redcross.org.au/basketball to get involved as well. This is going to dominate week 15 as well. It should, but there are some hugely entertaining, important games coming up. It's headlined by that opener that we spoke about, Cairns and New Zealand. This is a weekend. As with the best thing about a smaller competition is, we've got four playoff spots. Should be five. But we've got four playoff spots. And they're all going to play each other over the next couple of weeks. Yes. And it starts this weekend.
Look, I am super excited for Thursday, because I'm telling you, who's going to stop Scottie Hobson? That's the question. And guess what? I got an answer. Defensive player of the year, DJ Newbill. That's the matchup. Mm-hmm. All right? Mm-hmm. Both of those guys are playing some sensational basketball, so it's going to be great to see those two guys go ahead. But I'm putting my hand up now and saying Cairns is going to hold it down and win at home, because they are an extremely tough outfit at home.
I like Cairns going to Sydney again. If they go 2-0 for the weekend, a place they've already won, they will make the four. Well, I think they'll make the four anyway, even if they split the weekend, but I think they'll make the four. They'll make the three. There you go. What are you looking forward to?
Well, both those games, super interesting, right, Cairns? For me, the Adelaide-Melbourne and the New Zealand-Brisbane, even if New Zealand lose in Cairns, right, I feel like for those teams, Adelaide and Brisbane in particular, their season is on the line with these games this week. Brisbane hanging tough. Lamar Patterson has been amazing over recent times, but what are they? 9-11?
9-11.
They fall 9-12. I mean, 14 losses, I think, is probably going to keep you out the way things are playing. I think you need to be 15-13 to make it.
Ooh.
So,
Can't wait for it. Week 15 is going to be outstanding. NBL double overtime at NBL to make sure you get involved as well. Hit us up at NBL. Hashtag see incredible. And I can't believe we've got through the entire show. You haven't even raised up my cardigan. My cardigan. Brand new cardigan.
Oh, we forget it.
Broke it out.
Gibbo to get on it. Uh-oh. He sounded out of different.